Hi, let's talk about intercostal spaces. In this video, we'll discuss a typical intercostal space. So let's harken back to the osteology of the thorax. Recall there are 12 thoracic vertebrae. Each vertebrae articulates with a pair of costi, or ribs. So there are 12 pairs of ribs. Between these pairs of ribs are intercostal spaces. These intercostal spaces are named for the rib that is superior to them. So this is the first intercostal space, this is the second intercostal space, and so on and so forth. The inferior margin of each rib is a region known as the costal groove, and this is going to be important for the neurovascular bundle that's going to predominantly serve the intercostal space. And the region where these ribs articulate with vertebrae are known as the costovertebral joints. Let's take a look at those. So here is a posterior view of a rib. There's the head of the rib, there's a neck of the rib, and just towards the end, there's a tubercle associated with the neck of the rib. Now let's look over here at this illustration. We can see two thoracic vertebrae. There's one and there's the other. This is more of a posterolateral look at them. So anterior is that way, posterior is that way. And we can see that the head of the rib is going to articulate between two bodies. And so we'll see that there are these facets that the head of the rib fits in. That tubercle of the rib is going to be received by a facet on the transverse process of the vertebrae. So there are effectively two joints here that comprise the costovertebral joint, one for the head of the rib and one for the tubercle. Now, we think of the bony thorax as something protective, but we also need to consider that it's a dynamic space as well, that it's capable of expansion and then relaxation. And one way to conceptualize this is to think of that costovertebral joint as the joint for a bucket hinge. And so the handle of this bucket is able to be elevated and then depressed back down. And when that handle is elevated, one might presume that there is more space between the handle and the bucket. It's the same with the thoracic cavity. As the ribs are expanded upwards and outwards, the thoracic cavity gains more volume. And this is going to be important when we consider how the thoracic cavity affects ventilation. So let's look at the intercostal muscles, of which there are three major types. All three of these types are going to affect the motions of the costovertebral joints, hence affecting whether the ribs are moving upwards and outwards or inwards and downwards. So let's look at the most superficial muscles. These are the external intercostals, so they were exquisitely well named. The external intercostal muscles have fibers which run anteromedially. So if you think of someone putting their hands in their pockets, the directions of their fingers would be commensurate with the directions of these fibers. When they contract, they pull the ribs upward and outward, much like elevating the handle of a bucket. This increases the volume of the thoracic cavity, hence decreasing pressure, hence allowing air to move from atmospheric pressure to reduced pressure within the lungs. These external intercostal muscles are distributed predominantly posterolaterally. There is a portion of these muscles which is connective tissue present anteriorly, and we refer to this as the membranous portion of the external intercostals, and this is just fascia. Deep to the external intercostal muscles are the internal intercostal muscles. The internal intercostal muscle fibers run inferolaterally, so the opposite direction of the external intercostal muscles. Let me just draw the external intercostal muscle fibers we can see them running this way. So when the internal intercostal muscles contract, they pull the ribs downward and inward, thereby decreasing the volume of the thoracic cavity, thereby increasing the pressure, and are more involved with force expiration. These internal intercostal muscles are more distributed anterolaterally, and their most posterior portions within the intercostal space are more membranous. Deep to the internal intercostal muscles are the neurovascular bundles. So the intercostal nerve, artery, and vein, which serve these muscles. And then deep to the neurovascular bundles, we'll have a group of muscles known as the innermost intercostal muscles. They're not shown here, but these fibers run more superior-inferiorly. And they will be synergistic to the internal intercostal muscles, meaning they'll help pull the ribs downward and inward to aid with forced exhalation. So here we can see cadaverically some of these muscles. So this is a good place to see the external intercostal muscles, and we can even see how this transitions into a more membranous region, more anteriorly. And then just deep to the external intercostal muscles, so these intercostal spaces have their external intercostal muscles dissected away. We can see the internal intercostal muscles and their fibers. And then down here, surrounded in orange, we could see a posterior look at the anterior thoracic wall. So there's the manubrium, a couple of clavicles, and we can see these innermost intercostal muscles, as well as a type of innermost intercostal muscle known as the transversus thoracis. Now, if we look over here, we can see a region where those innermost intercostal muscles have been dissected away. And this allows us to see the neurovascular bundles, which are serving that intercostal space. Keep in mind, this is superior, this is inferior, and predominantly these bundles are going to be along the superior margin of the intercostal space, as we will now see. So serving the intercostal space is a bundle of an intercostal vein, artery, and nerve, as well as a collateral bundle. So let's look at each of these. So the vein is draining this space. It is most superior in this group. And that's going back to an area known as the azygos system, which we'll discuss in a later video. That azygos system is the venous system which drains the thoracic wall posteriorly. There's also an intercostal artery, which will have two sources. That intercostal artery comes from posterior intercostal arteries from the thoracic aorta, and also from anterior intercostal branches from the internal thoracic artery. We also have an intercostal nerve. This is the most inferior within the bundle that's housed by this costal groove. The intercostal nerve is a ventral primary ramus of a thoracic spinal nerve. So it's the VPR of spinal nerves T1 through T11. And most of T1 is going with the brachial plexus, and a little of it is going out into that intercostal space. Now, the we can oftentimes remember this arrangement as VAN, vein, artery, nerve. The collateral bundle are all branches from these, and they take the opposite arrangement. So there is a nerve, an artery, and a vein, nav, but the vein is always closest to the rib. The collateral bundle tends to be very small, and it is not sheltered by a costal groove. So let's take a look at these intercostal arteries and their sources. So all of what we're seeing here is an intercostal artery, and the predominant blood supply are posterior intercostal arteries, and these are regular branches from the thoracic aorta. There's also a collateral blood supply coming from the internal thoracic artery, which is a branch of the first part of the subclavian artery, as you may recall. And so intercostal arteries have two forms of blood supply. Now, the first and second intercostal spaces, their posterior intercostal arteries don't come from the thoracic aorta. They actually come from a vessel known as the highest or supreme intercostal artery. This is a branch of the costocervical trunk coming from the second part of the subclavian artery. It's quite variable and it's typically absent on the left. But the remaining spaces 3 through 11 come from the thoracic aorta. In terms of the anterior intercostal branches, the first 6 intercostal spaces are direct branches from the internal thoracic artery. And then the 7th through 9th spaces come from the musculophrenic artery, which is a branch of the internal thoracic artery. The internal thoracic artery descends, and then it branches into the superior epigastric artery, and then the musculophrenic artery. In terms of intercostal veins, there's a similar situation where there's collateral drainage. To the posterior, we have posterior intercostal veins that are draining into the azygos system. And then we have anterior that are draining into the internal thoracic. Now again, we have segmentation depending on level. So the first intercostal space drains into what's known as the supreme intercostal vein. These drain typically directly into the brachiocephalic veins. The second, third, and fourth intercostal spaces drain into the superior intercostal veins. On the right side, the superior intercostal vein drains into the azygos system. On the left side, typically directly into the brachiocephalic vein. And then the remainder of the spaces, 5 through 11, drain into the azygos system, which we'll discuss in much further detail in a subsequent session. That azygos system drains into the superior vena cava. So we've discussed an intercostal space, what it is, the various layers of muscle within external, internal, and innermost intercostal, and the relationship of the neurovascular bundle as intermediate between internal and innermost intercostal muscles. We've also discussed the relative relationships of the neurovasculature to ribs themselves and the various branches which are supplying intercostal arteries and veins. This is your summary slide. Thank you very much for your time.